Hi dear students, in the previous class we have learned orbital mechanics. So we started with the topic. What is the topic? We tried to find the orbital time period as well as velocity of the satellite in its orbit with the help of two forces acting on the satellite. One is centrifugal force, another one is centripetal force. Using these two forces which are equal and working opposite direction on the satellite, we tried to find out the velocity of the satellite as well as the time period of the orbit. Okay, today we will discuss the next topic, that is Kepler's three laws of planetary motion. So John Kepler developed three laws of planetary motion by carefully observing the behavior of the planets in the solar system. So out of three laws, the first law is the orbit of any smaller body revolving around a larger body is always an ellipse. You can see here, this is the sun, okay, and say consider this is the earth. So earth is a smaller body compared to the sun. So earth, when revolving around the sun, it tries to follow an elliptical orbit. Okay, this is what is the first law proposed by the Kepler. The second law is the smaller body which is revolving around a larger body sweeps out equal areas in equal time intervals. What is that? The orbit of a smaller body sweeps out equal areas in equal time intervals. For example, the time taken by the Earth, okay, say for example, to cover the area A6 is T6. If the time taken in the same area is there at A1, okay, if the earth is covering the same area, say A1, which is equal to A6, then it will cover that area A1, okay, in the time T1, which is equal to the time T6. So the smaller body which is revolving around a bigger body sweeps out equal areas. For example, say A4 and A1 are equal, then the time interval, that is T6, T1, also equal. So this is what the smaller body sweeps out equal areas in equal time intervals. The next law is, what is the next law? Whatever we have studied in the previous session, that is finding the orbital time period using the centrifugal and centripetal forces acting on the satellite. Okay, what is that actually? T equal to 2 pi r power 3 by 2 by mu power 1 by 2. Okay, so squaring on both sides, we will get T square equal to 4 pi square a cube by mu. Okay, this is the third law proposed by Kepler only. That means how we derived the time period or orbital period for a satellite using centrifugal and centripetal forces, okay, actually it is derived by the Kepler, and he proposed it as the third law of planetary motion. What it says? The square of the period of the revolution of the smaller body about the larger body, which is revolving around the larger body, equals a constant multiplied by the third power of semi-major axis of the orbital ellipse, which is, see here, this constant multiplied by the third power of a semi-major axis. A means semi-major axis, small a means semi-major axis, and capital T is orbital period, and we know that mu is the Kepler's constant. In the previous lecture, we tried to write the equation T equal to 2 pi r power 3 by 2, where we said that r is nothing but the distance from the satellite to the center of the earth actually. So we assumed that the orbit is a circular orbit, and we tried to find the orbital time period in the previous session which we have covered, okay. But actually the Kepler's third law is, actually Kepler's first law is, the smaller body is revolving around a larger body in an elliptical path. When it is an elliptical path, we need to consider r, that is the distance from the center of the earth to the satellite, say r, we need to replace by a, that is called as a semi-major axis of the elliptical orbit. clear? Next, we in the previous session we discussed that three elements. One is velocity of the satellite, second one is orbital period, and the distance from the satellite to the center of the Earth. If these three are known, we can know the location of the satellite. We can know the location of the satellite. Apart from these three, there are six more quantities. Okay, there are six more quantities with which the location of the satellite can be known. And these six quantities are called as orbital elements. Okay, so to specify the exact location of the satellite, six quantities are to be known. These quantities are called as orbital elements. What are they? One is, the first one is eccentricity of the elliptical orbit, semi-major axis of the elliptical orbit. Next, time of perigee of the elliptical orbit. Okay, the next one is right ascension of ascending node, and next one is inclination, and the last one is argument of perigee. Argument of perigee. What are these? Eccentricity, semi-major axis, time of perigee, right ascension of ascending node, inclination, argument of perigee. These are the six quantities which are called as orbital elements. If they are known, if we are able to calculate these six quantities, then we will be able to locate the satellite. We will be able to identify the location of the satellite very easily. Let us see the definitions of these six quantities. Before defining that, there are two more quantities actually we need to know in order to know the six quantities. One is apogee point, another one is perigee point. Okay, apogee point means, say for example, this is the Earth and this is the satellite. If the satellite is placed, if the distance between the satellite and the Earth is very far, okay, we call it as apogee point. If the distance between the satellite and the Earth is very, very less, shortest point, then we call it as a perigee point. Apogee point means, if the distance between the satellite and the Earth is very high, we call that point called as apogee point. And if the distance between the satellite and the Earth is very, very less, we call that that point or the location of the satellite as perigee point. So we define apogee and perigee. The farthest point from the planet to the satellite is called apogee point. The nearest point from the satellite to the planet to the satellite is called as perigee point. Next one is right ascension. What is meant by right ascension? The angular distance measured eastward in equatorial plane from the axis is called as right ascension. It is actually x-axis, from the x-axis. Okay, from the x-axis. So let us see here. You can see a picture here. You can see the picture here. For example, there are three axes, Z, Y and X. Okay. So, for example, the satellite is at perigee point. The satellite is at perigee point. This is the satellite. Okay. So, you are measuring the angular distance from the x-axis, to the perigee point. To the perigee point where the satellite is. This is called as right ascension. This is called as right ascension. Okay. What is meant by ascending node? Right, we are telling that right ascension of ascending node. Right, okay, what then, if there is ascending node, then there will be descending node. What is meant by ascending node actually? We are considering here the satellite is moving in an inclined orbit rather than the parallel orbits like LEO, MEO and GEO. If the satellite is moving in an inclined orbit, that means the orbital plane is making some angle with the equatorial plane greater than 0 degrees. Okay, so if that is the case, okay, If that is the case, for example, say this is Earth, okay, this is the equator, and you can see inclined orbit means it will be like this. Inclined orbit means it will be like this. Okay, so the satellite will be crossing the equator, okay, when it is moving upward, and also satellite will be crossing the equator when it is moving downward. Okay, when it is moving downward, when it is moving, when the satellite is moving in upward direction, when the satellite is moving in upward direction, okay, it crosses a particular point called as ascending node, called as ascending node, that is taken as the z axis extended downwards. Okay, this is called, say for example, this is called as ascending node. Okay, and also the satellite will be moving or cutting or moving downward direction, crossing the equator, we call it as descending node. So there are two nodes for any orbit, for any inclined orbit. One is ascending node, another one is descending node. See here, right ascension of ascending node means the angle made by the sat, the angle taken from the x-axis to the satellite perigee point when the satellite is moving in the ascending, from the ascending node, that is moving in upward direction, crossing the, moving in upward direction, crossing the equator. Okay, are you okay? Fine. I repeat here, when the satellite is at is going to perigee point, that is moving in upward direction, crossing the equator, okay, the angular measurement from the x-axis to the perigee point is called as right ascension of ascending node, is called as right ascension of ascending node. Okay, this is one definition. And we know that what is inclination, the angle, just now I said what is inclined orbit, the angle that the orbital plane makes with the equatorial plane greater than 0 degrees is called inclination. Okay, then what is argument of perigee? The angle measured along from the orbit from the ascending node to the perigee is called as a argument of a perigee. Okay. So this angle is called as argument of perigee. From ascending node to the perigee path is called as, the angle measured from the ascending node to the perigee part is called as argument of perigee, omega. Okay, I think these definitions are clear. Okay, now we go to another concept called as look angle determination, which with which will be, it will be very easy for the antenna to direct towards, to point towards the satellite. Okay, so what is meant by look angle? The angle to which an earth station antenna must be pointed to communicate with the satellite are called as look angles, are called as look angles. What is look angle? What is look angle? The angle to which an earth station antenna must be pointed to communicate with the satellite is called as look angle. There are two types of look angles. There are two types of look angles. One is azimuth angle, another one is elevation angle. What are the types of look angles? One is azimuth angle, another one is elevation angle. Let us see what are azimuth and elevation angles. There are two pictures which are same actually, okay, which are depicting the same azimuth and elevation angles. Okay, so you can see the definition first. Azimuth angle is measured, okay, eastward from geographic north to the projection of the satellite path on the horizontal plane at the earth station. What is azimuth angle? It is measured eastward from the geographic north to the projection of satellite path on the horizontal plane. Okay, right, we'll see here. You can see here there is a vertical plane here, or zenith 90 degrees, or local vertical you can call. Okay, Okay. You can see here, there is a, so this is the planet, this is the satellite. This is the satellite. Okay. So I have drawn one path to the, from the earth station to the satellite. An imaginary path from the earth station to the satellite. What I have done? I have drawn another path, okay, from the earth station to the projection of the satellite onto the horizontal plane. This is the projection. This is satellite. It is the projection on the horizontal plane. So what we are doing here, we are taking and we are measuring an angle from where? From north to where? Projection of path on the satellite. This is the projection of path of the satellite. Okay. From north to the projection path of the satellite, if we take the angle, okay, in which direction? Eastward, this side. Okay, eastward. From east, not from this side. From this side, I am taking the angle from the north, geographical north, to the projection path of the satellite. So that angle is called as azimuth angle. That angle is called as azimuth angle. Then what is elevation angle? Elevation angle is measured upward from the local horizontal plane at the earth station to the satellite path. Or you can say, okay, the angular measurement between the projection path of the satellite to the path of the satellite. Okay, to the path of the satellite in upward direction. Are you able to understand this? This is the satellite is projected here onto the local horizontal plane. I have drawn a line from the earth station to the point where the satellite is projected on the horizontal plane. Okay, this is the satellite. I have drawn one line from the satellite to the earth station. If I take the angular measurement from the projection path, okay, from the projection path to the path of the satellite, okay, in upward direction, this is called elevation angle. Azimuth angle and elevation angle plays an important role for the antenna, earth station antenna, to point towards the direction of the satellite. So pointing the earth station antenna towards the satellite is very much important for establishing best communication path between the earth station antenna and the satellite. You can see here, there are equations to find the elevation angle as well as azimuth angle. Okay, so elevation angle is defined in terms of cos of elevation angle equal to RS sin psi by D, where D equal to RS into 1 plus RE by RS minus 2 RE by RS cos psi power 1 by 2. So what are these RE, RS and all? Okay, you can see D is the vector drawn from the earth station to the satellite. RE is the vector drawn from the center of the earth to the earth station. Okay, psi is the central angle. Sigma is the central angle. Psi is the angle measured between RE and D. LE, capital LE, there are two here, two parameters, capital LE and small LE. Capital LE means number of degrees in latitude that the earth station is in north from the equator. Small LE means number of degrees in longitude that the earth station is west from the Greenwich meridian, and LS is the west longitude. You can see this diagram. Okay, so this is the earth, center of the earth. Okay, this is the earth station. Okay, you have drawn the, this is the satellite. Okay, you have drawn a vector from the satellite to the earth station. You are calling it as D. You are calling it as D. This D is a, plays an important role in finding the elevation angle of the satellite of the earth station antenna to the satellite. Okay, so see here, the local, the angular measurement from the local horizontal plane to the D. Okay, the vector D is nothing but elevation angle. So this D is very much important, and it is expressed in terms of RS. RS means the distance from the satellite to the center of the earth. What is RE? It is the radius of the earth. It is the radius of the earth. What is psi here? It is the angular measurement from the radius of the earth to the vector D. Okay, so all these, using all these parameters, we are defining the elevation, we are finding the elevation angle formula. The next one is azimuth angle formula. In order to find the azimuth angle, first an intermediate angle has to be calculated, because the intermediate angle permits the correct 90 degree quadrant to be found for an azimuth angle that can lie anywhere from 0 to 360 degrees clockwise direction. That is alpha equal to, this is intermediate angle, alpha equal to tan inverse of tan ls minus le, okay, mod of ls minus le by sine of le. So where azimuth angle is now can be calculated as 180 degrees minus alpha. Okay, so what we have learned here today, now we have learned what are the Kepler's three laws of planetary motion. Okay, what are look angles? So what is meant by elevation angle? What is meant by azimuth angle? Okay, in the next class we'll try to discuss few more interesting concepts like orbital perturbations, what is sun transit, what is meant by, what are the effects of eclipses on the satellite, etc. Thank you very much.